Welcome, everybody.
Morning.
Who's able to come out and be with us live today. Welcome to our social media followers on Facebook. Welcome to those who may be watching us later on YouTube. I don't know who I'm preaching to out there this week, but it's my desire that this message touches you in a special way to bring you closer to our Lord Jesus Christ. Desire is my topic this week. Desire is to long or hope for. People have a desire for success. Desire is to express a wish or a request. They desire an answer. You know, in this fast-paced and troubled country, the world that we currently live in, I just wonder, what is your desire today? All that evil lurking around us, what is your desire today? Is it for worldly gain with the desire to sell out your soul for money and power to Satan? And I believe that many people in Hollywood and people who have political positions have the desire to destroy our country. Mm-hmm. Or is it your desire for the kingdom of Christ with a desire to draw closer to Him every day, to trust in God and believe that we are covered by the work on the cross, and for us to pull together as good believing Christians and do what is right for our country and support life? We all know where we need to be in Election Day. Now, my last sermon was on desperate. We've been talking about the D words. I call them the deadly D words. There's a lot of D words out there Greg and I have been preaching on. So the last sermon was on desperate. I'm going to ask you this question. Do you have a desperate desire for the Lord?
Yes.
Wonderful. Or do you have a burning desire for something? I always heard that term, burning desire. I got a burning desire. Or are you on the total opposite end of the spectrum and have no desire for anything at all? No desire for anything at all. Now in Psalms 37 and verse 4, it reads, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart." Pretty basic. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. People today succeed for a variety of reasons. And the one thing they all have in common is a desire, perhaps a burning desire. I believe that your success in this life would begin with a burning desire for the Lord and have the presence of the Holy Spirit with you. With that desire and trusting all things are possible with Christ, you would allow the Holy Spirit to guide you through failures and issues to achieve the goals that God has planned for you. If you have that desire to rely on God and the Holy Spirit, then the more likely it is your goal will be achieved. Now, oftentimes we are tempted. We're pulled away. Temptation takes a place. And in 1 Corinthians, it talks about it in chapter 10 and verse 13. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, He will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. He gives us that escape clause. Did you know that the Lord's Prayer deals with desires? Anybody know that? The petitions in the Lord's Prayer represent our basic desires. When these desires are present in your spiritual life and become the inner driving force of your life, you will be successful with those desires. Prayer is the soul's sincere desire. So in the Lord's Prayer, you have the very essence of prayer and the desire linked together as one. I'm going to recite the Lord's Prayer for you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
When we say, hallowed be your name, we are reminding ourselves to desire that his name, which is in fact is always holy, should also be considered holy among men. And when we say your kingdom come, it will surely come whether we will it or not, but we are stirring up our desires for the kingdom so that it can come to us and we can deserve to reign there. When we say deliver us from evil, we are reminding ourselves of the desire to reflect on the fact that we do not want to rely on and enjoy the state, the fact that we do not yet enjoy the state of blessedness, and we shall suffer no evil. So we don't have that enjoyable state of blessedness right now. We want to be saved from that evil. The desire for his will to be done, not ours. The desire for him to provide for us. Give us our daily bread. The desire for us to forgive others. We'll talk about it in that prayer. The desire not to be led into temptation. Perhaps now you know the desires of the prayer. You may pray it in a very different way. Because what happens is prayer becomes repetition. We say the words, but do we really fully understand and appreciate what those words mean to God and to you? Can you apply what you're saying through that prayer? The Lord's Prayer was taught to the disciples. You can find it in the Bible. It taught it to the disciples because they came to Jesus asking him to be taught how to pray. They had no idea. And they said, please teach us how to pray. So the Lord's Prayer comes in response to their desire to know how to pray more effectively. It is therefore an answer to prayer or their soul's sincere desire. He gave them that prayer. And we have that prayer for ourselves today. It is a prayer which in itself is an answer to prayer. And the key to all answered prayer. When I was preparing for my sermon this week, I found a 17th century quote. I forgot the author, but I found this quote that was written in the 17th century. That's a long time ago. To pray is to desire. To desire is to pray. And since if we desire improper things, we may be cursed with the granting of our prayer. It behooves us to desire only high and worthy things. Now what this quote is saying is strong desire almost leads to getting of what is desired. That means if you desire something wrong, you will probably succeed in getting it. And so your very success becomes a curse. There are two tragedies in life. One is not to get your heart's desires, and the other is to get it. In other words, sometimes the worst thing that can happen is to get what we want most. The worst thing that can happen is to get what we want most. Now, in the Bible, there are several stories about people getting what they wanted most, but it was really a curse. One of those stories that come to mind is the prodigal son. Remember the prodigal son? He wanted his inheritance now. He wanted all that money now. He had the desire to have this other style of life and not be associated with the family and the father and his brother. He wanted to take his money and go out and have a good old time. So, what happens in the prodigal son? He got what he wanted, but ended up with the pigs and nothing to show for it. Think about what happened. He lost everything. Be careful about what you pray for. So you see, the goal of prayer is not answered prayer, but divine desire. The highest goal of prayer is not to get what we want, but to come to want what God wants us to have. Let me repeat that. To come to want what God wants us to have. Now, you can see this clearly in Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. He had a strong desire to escape the events that awaited him. He knew what was laid out there. He had a normal human desire to live and not die. Plus, the pure and holy repulsion of taking on the sins of the world. He wanted to deal with that. The human part was coming into play. Both his human and divine nature had a desire to let the cup pass unconsumed. The goal of his prayer, however, was not to get that sincere desire fulfilled, that earthly, fleshly desire fulfilled, but to get his desire conforming to the will of God. His desire to conform what his Father wanted for him. He was able to win his victory and let his Father's desire dominate his own. We pray what the Holy Spirit impress upon us, what the Father's desires for us are. That is why he prayed, "Not my will, but your will be done." Amen. Desire determines destiny. And because Jesus was able to wrestle his desires into a proper order where God's desires took priority over his own, he went to the cross. He died on the cross for our sins. He became the Savior of the world. The destiny of all mankind hung in the balance. And these conflicting desires struggled for priority. Without Jesus taking that and doing the will of the Father, we would not have the message of the cross. We would not have the cross to turn to. Nobody knows better than Jesus that desire determines destiny. And that is why the Lord's Prayer that he taught his disciples is a prayer that is designed to determine desires. We need to understand the Lord's Prayer so we can understand altogether how to pray as believing Christians should pray. In Psalms 145 and verse 19, he fulfills the desire of those who fear him. He also hears their cries and saves them. Anybody have the fear of the Lord? Should always be a little bit afraid of the fear of the Lord. Yeah. Lord, what I am doing right now, is it pleasing to you?
Right.
Having that fear is what's going to help us stay closer to him and desire to do his will and not ours. One of the toughest things in life is living with unfulfilled desires. To experience desire is a normal part of life. For example, it's natural for an infant crying for milk. Some desires we have are good, like the desire to help somebody in need. Some desires are bad, like the desire to possess something that really doesn't belong to us, or to God really saying, I don't want you to have that, but somehow you're going to get it. Some desires are just a result of being human. Like the desire for food, like the desire for love, like the desire for friendship and companionship. These are normal desires and become twisted when they're not surrendered to God. The Bible says, hope deferred makes the heart sick. That's in Proverbs 13:12. Unfulfilled desire can be painful to live with. Mm-hmm. Some people deal with this pain by trying to eliminate desire altogether from their lives, mm-hmm. pretending it's not there or somehow managing to push it aside. Mm-hmm. We bury desire beneath our busyness or our sense of humor. I've seen people that have this great sense of humor because it's a mess. Yeah. They hide behind that. But when we do that, we lose something. To experience desire is to open our hearts to the possibility of pain, but to shut down our desire is to die altogether. So if we lose our desire, we're going to lose our desire to pray, we're going to lose our desire for the Lord. God only knows where you're going to wind up. I can kind of take a guess on that. In closing, I'm going to leave you with a few scriptures. They're short scriptures. I know a lot of people memorize scriptures. I just go to the book and read them. I have a few memorized, but Proverbs 10:24. What the wicked dreads will come upon him, but the desire of the righteous will be granted. Matthew 5:6. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Their desires will be fulfilled. And in Romans 13:13-14, let us walk properly as in the daytime, not in orgies and in drunkenness, and not in sexual immorality, not in quarreling and in jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires, because the flesh will take over those fleshly desires. The world and its desires will pass away. This world and its desires of the world will pass away, but whoever does the will of God will live forever in eternity in heaven. Amen.
Amen.